Good morning, everyone. We welcome you this morning on a beautiful Sunday morning and New City Church Live on live stream. I trust you had a great week in the Lord. We're anticipating a blessed day with you. We miss you as always, and I can't wait till we all come together again. Well, let's prepare our hearts just before we go into worship. I'm going to ask Brother Sammy to come and lead us in prayer. So let's just warm our hearts before the Lord and ask him to minister to us as we bless his holy name. Brother Sam?
Let's pray. Father, we are so grateful to God to you this morning. We thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness. We thank you for the gift of life, O God, this morning in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray, O God, our Lord, as we come into a time of worship and praise, O God, that your word, O God, will go forth in power. I pray, O God, that our praises and our worship, O God, will come unto you as a sweet-smelling fragrance, O God, in the name of Jesus Christ. I pray, O God, that you will be glorified in our worship, O God, even in our homes. We pray, O God, that your presence, O God, will be in our homes, O God, by the power of your Spirit. And we pray that your word will go forth in power and touch, O God, even in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let the atmosphere, O God, in our homes, O God, change, O God, because of your power and because of your presence. You said, where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in their midst, O God. We know, O God, that in various homes, O God, more than two people are there, O God. I pray that you bless your people, O God, as they listen, O God, this morning. Be glorified and be exalted, O God. Let there be infusion of your power and your presence this morning, in Jesus' name. Let's rejoice in the Lord. Amen.
My hiding place, my hiding place. Many ask, why is God allowing all of this to happen? The truth is, everything that's been happening in the four corners of the earth was already prophesied in the Bible. This is the inevitable fulfillment of Scripture. These are the signs that precede the return of the Lord Jesus. God has always allowed humanity to go through difficult times. But the question is, why? We need to remember that when everything is going well, when the wind is at our back, our tendency is to relax and rely on our own strength. Many imagine that they are self-sufficient. They forget about God and even deride Him. But moments like these show us that we are nothing. In the blink of an eye, an invisible enemy can appear to take the lives of thousands with no regard for social class, race, or status. Where are the powerful ones now? Their money and power can do nothing to stop this virus from spreading. In times like this, we see just how fragile and insignificant we really are. Only in times like these do we stop to reflect and bow before the one true God. It's only in the storms of life, in the toughest of times, when people humble themselves before the Most High and seek His help. The writer of Psalms says, "My suffering was good for me, for it taught me to pay attention to your decrees." Going through deserts teaches us much more than the comfort of green pastures. How many people have given up on praying, but have now started to pray again? How many have been spiritually lazy, but are now being shaken awake to restore the relationship with God? How many had drifted away, but have come back to God in this crisis? God doesn't always change our situation, but He uses the situation to change us. God is using this time to test the faith of those who serve Him. Many are discovering that they spent their entire lives building their houses on the sand. Now that supernatural faith is needed, they've collapsed after years of not practicing what they were taught. One thing is certain: whoever builds their lives on the rock will go through storms, yet remain unshaken. Storms come to everyone, but only those who hear and practice the word remain. God won't keep us from being thrown into a lion's den, but He'll close the mouths of the lions. God won't keep us from being thrown into a fiery furnace, but He'll ensure that not even a single hair of our head is burned. Let's have this faith as we go through these times, and in the end, we'll come out stronger. But He'll close the mouths of the lions. God won't.
Hi everyone, thank you for joining us. Thank you for joining us this morning. I pray that you are blessed. I pray that you are just filled with the Spirit of God concerning this morning service. We are here with you while you are home. Again, it's not always the same watching empty seats, but we believe that the fact that you are home, you're with us. And you're watching, and you are worshiping with us. I hope you are blessed by the worship that we had this morning, and I know you will be blessed also by the sermon that we have with you. Again, thank you for joining with us. As we are transitioning in that time, we just want you to keep our church in prayer, keep the churches in prayer. We want you to be encouraged, want to encourage you, and to be encouraged concerns to your finances and your offering. So if you want to give this morning, your tithes and your offering, we have many ways to do it. You can go online to our website, ncclive.com/give, and you'll be able to do that. But we do recommend that you use our e-transfer, newcitygiving@gmail.com. And while you do that, please mention your name, your full name, and address, so we'll be sure to, for our counting purposes, to be sure to do things that what we should do. So we want to just encourage you to keep following us on our many social media page, our YouTube page, like you are right now, NCC live stream, our Facebook page, New City Church Brentford. You can follow us and see all the details that we have for you throughout the week. Tonight we're going to have our PM service with Jeffrey Smith at 7 p.m. in our Zoom application. So if you want to know all the details of how to get there, our meeting ID, just come into our Facebook page and we'll be sure to have you present with us. God bless you.
And we pray that you enjoy the rest of the service. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Kirby, and thank you, team, for making this morning possible. And for those of you just joining us, welcome again. I just want to introduce this video to you. This video that you're about to watch is a testimonial from Africa and a massive crusade that took place on the African continent, where many people came to get saved and healed and set free. This testimony is about a lady who came in a wheelchair, and I want you to hear her encounter with the Lord. There may have been a disappointment, but there was also an appointment. So do watch this now. Thank you.
We are all broken in one way or another, and God longs to meet us, not always in the way we want, but truly in the way we need. As the lights were being turned off, and when the field was empty, I talked with a woman named Sarah, who I had seen throughout the crusade. I asked what she thought God had done here, and if she was disappointed in him at all. What did she think of God's glory now? She came in a wheelchair, and was now going home, still in a wheelchair.
So I learned that faith works in love. That I can't hate the same God I wanted to do something for me. And I had to trust him. It's a testing of faith. I'm not ready to back down. And I guess when I get home tomorrow, they'll be like, oh, that's not what we're expecting, you know. But I have been begging God to heal the people around me of their unbelief so that they can see beyond the physical, you know. But at the end of the day, I'm going with something much more, you know. Yesterday, I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And I just feel complete. Like, that anger, that anxiety, that uncertainty, it's not there anymore, you know. I'd rather just stay in his will, the way he wants it, than stay on my own and be miserable. You know. The devil has been telling me, he didn't show up, you know. Don't even come today. Just go home. It's done. I told you so. But faith is a fight. So just saying that some people actually gave their life to Christ, you know. Just worth it. Knowing that Christ in us, the hope of glory, I've always desired the gift of the Spirit, and I got it, so it's worth it. I still witness miracles. And our timing is not God's timing. But when it's his time, he makes all things beautiful. It was all worth it. It was all worth it.
It was all worth it, she said. Isn't that powerful? That she said it was worth it because the Lord met her. He dealt with the greater issues of her heart. And so is Sarah's testimony. And so maybe our testimony. Sometimes we have disappointments with the Lord. Sometimes we don't understand all that is going on. And so we question. Have you been in that place of questioning God? And not understanding, and trying to reason what took place and if it was your fault or is it God's fault or whose fault is all of this. Anyhow, we want to turn to the scriptures this morning as we further look into this subject. And the message was entitled, How Did We Miss It? Or Why Did They Miss It? And so I want to look at this portion first of all. I'm going to do some teaching this morning. And as we look at the Bible in Luke chapter 24, we know that this is post-resurrection. That Jesus takes this walk with the disciples. Two of them are traveling from Jerusalem to the, and it's a road, it's a side road. They're on their way to Emmaus. And on the way to Emmaus, it's about a 7-mile journey, 11.26 kilometers. And he is with them traveling on this road. He's not recognized by them. And so he joins this conversation of two. And he says, what kind of conversation is this that you have with one another? You walk and are sad. You walk and are sad. You see, from Christ's perspective, they ought not to be sad. Even when Mary went to the tomb in Matthew 28, she was sad. And the angel had to tell her, why are you weeping? And so the question here is, again, they were walking and they were sad. And of course, Jesus reasoned with them. And they say, well, don't you know what happened? And he said, there was a great prophet in the land. And this prophet was mighty in deed and word before God and all the people and so on. So we see that they still saw Jesus as a mere prophet. And as he reasoned with them, they said they were hoping that he was going to be the one to redeem Israel. And besides all this, this is the third day since these things have happened. And of course, they even testified of what the women said, and still they didn't have a glimmer of hope. And so Jesus looks at them, and he says to them, even though the testimony of the women was that they found the tomb empty, Jesus turns around, and he looks at them, and he says, oh, fools, in the King James, oh, foolish ones, in the New King James, slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and have entered into his glory? Now you see, it's a pretty strong statement. It's not as strong as the one in Matthew chapter 5 where it talks about the fool. He said, well, whoever says, thou fool, shall be danger of hell fire. That word fool is stronger, and that word fool is the word moros, where we get the word moron from. And it is a very strong indicative word that we ought not to be calling people. And so Jesus uses another word for fool. It is anatos, and this means to act unwisely, to act foolishly, or to act without understanding. And so he looks at his disciples. He says, you know, you're slow of heart to believe. You are foolish in all that the prophets have spoken. He said, you have the testimony of the Word of God. You have the testimony of the prophets that preceded you. And they've been telling you for centuries that this is going to take place. Now, why did this happen? It's because we go back to Matthew chapter 16. And we look in Matthew 16, there we find that when Jesus had taken them in Caesarea Philippi, and there in the backdrop, I preached this a few weeks ago, and there in the backdrop, he said, who do men say that I am? And of course, he wanted to bring them beyond Jesus being Elijah, him being John the Baptist or one of the prophets that had risen from the dead. And so he answered, you know, he wanted to bring this revelation to them. And so in the backdrop of hell's gates and in the backdrop of the spirit of panic and all of this, he reveals himself. And Peter makes his powerful declaration in Matthew 16:16 and 17. He says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You may remember that message. And of course, Jesus commends him. He says, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. So he says, Simon, you're blessed. And he says, I'm going to give you the keys. Simon, you're going to be called Peter. On this rock, I will build my church, and the gates of Hades or hell shall not prevail against it. And whatever you bind will be bound on earth and bound in heaven. And so he gives him authority based on the revelation of him understanding that Jesus is the Christ. He is the Messiah, the Son of God. Now, notice, we didn't finish that portion a few weeks ago, but then he tells them and he commands them that they should tell no one that he was the Christ, because there are many reasons why they would have forced him to push out the Romans and be forced on David's throne, because their theology was still misconstrued. And I want you to understand that. And so then he goes on and he says in verse 21, he said, from that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised the third day. And so Peter listens to this. He only hears a part of what Jesus says, and Peter takes him aside, you know, and he begins to rebuke him. Can you imagine? You know, here you are a disciple and you start rebuking your rabbi. You start rebuking your teacher. And so Peter does this, pretty bold as he is. You know, he rebukes him. He says, Lord, far be it from you. Lord, this shall not happen to you. You know, pretty emphatic, isn't he? This shall not happen to you. This is what Peter says. And of course, Jesus turns and he says to Peter, get thee behind me, Satan. You are an offense to God. Pretty powerful comeback. Pretty powerful words from the Lord. And he says, he calls this spirit that is speaking out of the lips of Peter. And he says, Peter, just a few moments ago, you declared me to be the Messiah. You understood the Father's revelation. I gave you authority. And now I'm trying to tell you I must go to Jerusalem, that I must suffer at the hands of the Pharisees and the chief priests, and I will be killed and raised again the third day. But you see, Peter didn't hear all of what Jesus said. And that's why Peter pulled him aside and said, this will not happen to you. And I'm wondering, beloved, if we are guilty of the same. And is it for that very reason why those on the road to Emmaus, you know, were foolish, unwise, lacking understanding, and they were slow in their heart to believe all that the prophets had said? You see, you know, the cultural milieu of the day was that the Messiah is going to come, he's going to overthrow the Romans, and he's going to establish Israel's reign, and he's going to rule like David did, and he's going to be the son of David, and he's going to usher them into a new reign, a new era. And so this was their desire, and this was their, you know, heartfelt longing that the Messiah would come, and the prophets did say this would take place. But you see, the prophets also said the Messiah would come and suffer. Right from Genesis 3:15, he said he will bruise your heel. But it goes on to say later that he will crush your head. But there is the element of the bruising of the heel. And then, of course, in the book of Psalms, we see Psalm 22, that, you know, it talks about the suffering Messiah. We read that in Isaiah 52 and 53. We read about the suffering Messiah. Prophet Zechariah chapter 13, verse 6 and 7 talks about the suffering Messiah. And so Jesus said to his disciples, ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and enter into his glory? You see, they did not hear the fact that, yes, he must die, but he will be raised the third day and he will enter his glory. But you see, that theology was not in them. And so I think how we can miss what happens in our day when our world gets shaken by viruses or earthquakes or losses is that we have not embraced the full counsel of God. And I think this is something that, you know, sometimes what is popular in North America, we have this wealth gospel, we have this health gospel, we have this prosperity gospel that, you know, we just declare, we prophesy that no evil will come, that Jesus took all the suffering so the righteous will never have to suffer. Jesus took all the poverty so the righteous will never experience lack or loss or any tribulations or trials. And when we buy into this false narrative, beloved, we are buying into a gospel that is not the gospel of Jesus Christ. And this is why we can miss what is happening on the earth today, because our theology doesn't line up with the Word of God. And that's why they missed it. That's why they were slow to believe, because they missed the fact that he had been telling them all along that this is going to happen. He told them on numerous occasions that he was going to suffer and he was going to die, and that was not going to be the end, but that he would rise again and that there would be a glory at the end. But you see, we don't want to buy into that. We don't want to believe in suffering today. We don't want to believe like Sarah, you know, she went to the crusade in all hope that she would walk out of that wheelchair. But you see, God didn't heal her. And maybe while God healed some, he didn't heal all. And Sarah's testimony was that while she was hoping, but God did something greater for her, didn't he? He dealt with her heart. He dealt with her anger. He dealt with things that were deep inside of us, because we are that creature that has a soul, that has a will, that has emotions, that has to deal and wrestle with our emotions when things don't go our way. Now, some of us are maybe questioning, how long will this pandemic last? I can't be boxed up any longer. Well, you know, just this week I had a conversation with a Polish brother in the Lord, and he said, you know, he was reminding me that, you know, during World War II, when the Nazis came in and attacked Poland and Holland and all these nations, that in Poland that schools were shut for 6 long years. No kid went to school. For 6 years, we're not talking about 6 days or 6 weeks or 6 months, but we're talking 6 years. So hold on. We're not the only ones who've gone through trials. We're not the only ones who have suffered. We're not the only ones. So we ought not to think that this is something else. But I want you to know what Jesus did say. Jesus did tell us, came upon me in Antioch and Iconium and in Lystra, and the persecutions I endured. He said, yes, but the Lord rescued me from them all. The way the Lord rescued him, sometimes he prevented it, but sometimes Paul took lashes, Paul took beatings, and Paul took, you know, shipwrecks, because he was told right from his conversion when Ananias laid his hands on him, he said, tell this man how much he will suffer for my name's sake. And if that wasn't enough, later again when Abagus came down from the north country and he took Paul's belt and he tied himself with it, he said, the Holy Ghost says that this is what they will do to this man. They will bind him up. You see, because the Bible is clear. Indeed, all who desire to live godly lives in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Will be persecuted. While evil men and apostles go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. So I want you not to get disillusioned when things happen that rock our world, when things happen that shake your faith, because if your faith is in the natural and if your faith is in anything else but in the solid rock, Christ Jesus built upon the rock, then yes, he will allow things to shake, because he doesn't want you leaning on any false reed of Egypt or the world. He wants you to lean on him, the Christ, the living God, and build your hope on him. Can I hear an amen? Amen. So I want you to look, you know, because this is where it's at today. I mean, you know, let's go to John chapter 20. When we look at John chapter 20, we find at the beginning of John 20, the same thing takes place with the resurrection. And so after the resurrection, we see that on the first day of the week, that evening, the doors being shut, and the disciples were gathered and assembled, and Jesus came and stood in their midst, and he said, "Peace be with you." So he settles their fearful hearts. On the first day of the week, he appears to them while they're assembled behind shut doors. And of course, we know in this meeting that somebody is missing. One of the disciples is missing, and his name is Thomas. Thomas, called Didymus, or the twin, and Thomas is missing. He missed that meeting, and of course, they tell Thomas all about it. And when Thomas came, he goes, "Well," Thomas says, "I'm not going to believe. I'm not going to believe until I see it for myself, until my own naked eyes see it, until my own hands put my fingers to touch the print of the nails and put my fingers into the print of the nails and my hands into his side. I will not believe." You know, some people are like that, aren't they? They said, "Well, I'm not going to believe until God himself manifests himself to me and he shows me, not invisible, but he shows me who he is by some miracle or some appearance or something." Thomas was that natured at this very moment. He wouldn't believe the testimony of the disciples. And there are many people like that today. They don't believe your testimony that God changed your life. They don't believe your testimony that God touched you and transformed you and delivered you and set you free from so many things. And many of you had great, wonderful testimonies of the Lord. But there are people who still doubt. But this is not just anybody. This is Thomas, who had heard the words of Jesus, who had gone with Jesus to Lazarus' home, and who had seen Jesus raise Lazarus, who knew so many of the mighty deeds of God. This is not anybody. It is Thomas, one of the disciples. So anyways, a whole week goes by, and this is that Sunday. The next Sunday following, 8 days later, the Bible says in verse 26, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas was now with them. And Jesus came, and the doors were shut, and Jesus comes in their midst, and he says, "Peace to you." And again, he speaks peace over them. He speaks shalom over them. And then of course, what happens is that Thomas, he goes right to Thomas. Jesus goes right to Thomas, and he makes a beeline to this man who said, "I will not believe," because he wants to win him. And I think that's the goal of every believer. That is the goal of Christ, is to win us to himself. And he makes a beeline to Thomas, and he says, "Thomas, reach your finger here and look at my hands. Reach your hands here and put it into my side. Do not be unbelieving, Thomas. Do not be unbelieving, but believing." That's the goal of the Messiah. The goal of the Messiah is to fill you with hope and to fill you with peace and fill you with faith. And so he made a beeline to the doubter in the group, and he did this. And of course, as a result, this disciple, and like the other disciples, Thomas makes a great declaration. He says, "My Lord and my God." This is a very powerful statement that we use to combat even the cults and the pseudo-Christians who don't declare Jesus Christ's lordship and equality with the Godhead. And Thomas, being a Jew, no Jew would call anybody on the earth God. And yet he makes his emphatic confession, testimonial. He says, "My Lord and my God." He had an encounter that very moment that he understood that Jesus was the Messiah of the Jews and, of course, the rest of the world. Can I hear an amen in your living rooms? Can I hear an amen wherever you are? Amen, amen, and amen. My Lord and my God. What a powerful revelation and a statement. And, of course, Jesus says to him, "Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. But blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe." And that is our generation. The generation that follows the ascension of Christ Blessed are you. Blessed am I, who have not seen him with our physical naked eye, but yet believe, because there is more to sight than the natural. There is a spiritual sight. There is spiritual hearing that God opens up, and God opens our eyes to see him for who he is. Amen. And so they were transformed, beloved. So they were transformed to such a degree that all of these apostles have great testimonies to our day. And I want to just say in the recap, you know what these are. James is the only one that is recorded in Holy Writ that became a martyr. I mean, as far as the disciples are concerned, not the deacons. But in Acts 12:2, we see that Herod takes a hold of James. He arrests James and he beheads James, and James is killed in Acts chapter 12. His life is taken. And so we record that James is willing to lay down his life for the gospel, lay down his life for Christ. Peter and Andrew are both crucified. But historians tell us that Peter refused to be crucified the same way as our Lord. He found himself not worthy to die in the same manner, so he hung upside down in Rome, fulfilling Jesus' prophecy over him in John chapter 21, when he had that long walk with Peter, asking if Peter loved him. Matthew, he went to Ethiopia, and there he was killed by the sword. John the Beloved, he was put in boiling hot oil, and there they tried to boil him to death. Try that for a moment. And they were not able to boil him to death, so they exiled him to Patmos as a prisoner, and there he had the revelation of the book of Revelation. And then there's James, the brother of Jesus. Now, we know that James, the brother of Jesus, was not a believer during the time when Jesus walked the earth. And he was an outsider with his mom. He often didn't attend his meetings. But now James, the brother of Jesus, historians tell us, was taken to the southeast pinnacle of the temple. And he was thrown over 100 feet down. Possibly the same pinnacle that Jesus was taken up to, and Satan tempted him there to cast himself down. They took James there and they thrust him forward, and he fell 100 feet down, but he didn't die. And because he didn't die, the others who were watching, bystanders, they came in and beat him with clubs until he did die. You see, then there's Bartholomew, also known as Nathanael. He became a missionary to Asia. He witnessed in modern Turkey, and there he was flayed to death in Armenia by the whips of men. Andrew, he was whipped by 7 soldiers, and then, if that wasn't enough, they tied his body to an X-shaped cross in Greece to prolong his agony until he died. And his followers said that he was being led to the cross. He said this as he was being led to the cross. He said, "I have long desired and expected this happy hour. The cross has been consecrated by the body of Christ hanging on it." He continued preaching to them next 2 days to all of his tormentors. Just like how Stephen said, "Father, forgive them." He kept appealing to them. Now, can you tell me of a theology? Can you tell me of a doctrine and an understanding that said, "I have longed and desired and expected this happy hour"? How is it that these disciples, one after the other, happily went to their crosses, happily went to the guillotines? Thomas went to India. There, what is known today as Thomas Hill, was speared down by the natives. I've been there. Matthias, who was chosen to replace Judas, was stoned. And then after his stoning, he was beheaded. Paul was arrested by Nero. And because being a Roman citizen, he was not allowed to be crucified on a Roman cross. They beheaded him. All of these who were at the beginning slow to believe corrected their theology, embraced that all those who desired to live godly shall be persecuted. They understood the cost of picking up their cross and following Christ. They understood that a disciple is not greater than their master, and what they did to their master, they will do to us. They understood. And beloved, I want to appeal to you this morning. All of these died as martyrs, which is the word for being a witness to the ends of the earth. They were true witnesses. They were true witnesses because they laid down their lives. In Matthew's gospel, we hear that the soldiers were paid off. They were told to perpetrate a story, fabricate a story that the disciples had stolen the body while they slept at night, and they had stolen this body, and that is why the body was missing from the tomb. Now, let me reason with you. If the disciples had stolen the body of Jesus, they might do this for some gain. But would you die for a lie? Would you die for a fabrication? Obviously not. And you know, all of these disciples, they were not together. They were all separate. One was in Ethiopia. One was in the Middle East and Turkey and Armenia and India, Rome. They're all separate on the different parts of the globe, preaching the gospel, sharing the love of God with their own little disciple bands. And they had given their lives for consecration. You know, today we enjoy live stream. We enjoy even having Zoom meetings. But let me tell you, our brothers and sisters in China are being arrested today. On Easter, the police came and arrested believers and Christians who are participating in Zoom Easter worship services. Several members of the China's heavily persecuted Early Rain Covenant Church were arrested by authorities. The watchdogs came and they came in. They infiltrated their ranks. They interrupted their meetings. They disrupted them. Too many examples to share. I think we need to understand that if we have a theology that doesn't balance with Scripture, then our world will always be rocking us. We will be sent into a tailspin of confusion. Because if we choose to believe part of the gospel and not the whole gospel. You know, Paul said in Philippians chapter 3, he said, that I may know him and that I may have fellowship in his sufferings. Paul understood that there was something about knowing Christ and knowing his sufferings and having fellowship in his sufferings. He said, indeed, in my body I bear the marks of the Lord Jesus Christ. But not only did he understand the fellowship of his sufferings and to be conformed to his death, he said, I know the power of his resurrection. Because in the midst of suffering, in the midst of being conformed to his death, we understand that God doesn't stand aloof or far away. He draws near to us and he allows us to taste the power of his resurrection. He allows us to trace grace upon grace. For in my weakness, Paul said, I have tasted that the grace of God is sufficient. Are you with me? Just like Sarah. Maybe she didn't get out of that wheelchair, but she got filled with the Holy Spirit. She got freed of anger and bitterness and all that heart disease that will kill her more than cancer. And I want you to hear me, beloved. I remember a few weeks ago also, I showed you a clip about an Egyptian brother who had escaped the torture of Egypt. And he said, the world is in two zones. One zone is comfort and the other zone is conflict. Over and over again. And I believe one of the reasons why we miss pandemics or pestilence or shakings, that come on the earth is because we don't heed the full counsel of God. Jesus forewarned that these things would come. Jesus said it in Matthew 24, Luke 21, and many other portions. He forewarned of these days. And if he said it, it will happen. But that's still not the end, is it? The end is still going to be glorious in the millennial. But we must pass through the valley of the shadow of death. But we ought not to fear evil. We ought not to fear those things that come upon the earth. We ought to rest in the Messiah. Rest in our Savior. Continue on. Now those two zones are being blurred, and maybe we're not living in such a comfortable zone. I think we're still more comfortable than many places on the earth. We still can engage in Zoom, and we can still engage in live stream. Where in China, that's all shut down. Can you imagine the believers in China right now? And so, Lord, we pray for them. We pray for our Chinese brothers and sisters, God, that do not have the platform of Zoom or the live streaming. And that those have been shut down and they have been quarantined and isolated. And yet they're willing to risk their lives to tell their neighbor and tell those who are their enemies about the love of Jesus. And Lord, we pray that we would not be rocked, oh God, when our world is shaken up by some trial. Whatever that trial is, but may we count it a joy. And may we say with the disciples, I have longed and desired for this day, this very happy hour, that I can partake of his sufferings, be made conformable to his death. God, I admit that even myself, we are so privileged and so blessed in this generation, in this North American context, that we know little of the sufferings of those right now who are suffering at the hands of the Fulani, at the hands of the jihadists, at the hands of their communist leaders, whether in North Korea or in Africa or in other parts of the world where the church is much underground but yet thriving. Lord, we pray that our brothers and sisters in North America will not become divided, but be united. More united now than ever. More intentional now than ever to see the gospel of Jesus preached. For we know that it is the gospel of Jesus Christ that is the hope and resurrection of our nation. It is only the gospel in the ears of politicians. It is the gospel in the ears of our neighbors. It is the gospel in the heart and ears of those who will hear it that will bring solace to their souls. And so, Father, I pray this morning with my brothers and sisters that you would make the church cohesive, make it strong, make it ever more intentional in getting the word out, in praying, in interceding and preaching the gospel in whatever methods and means you allow us to, Lord. And that we could say with the apostles, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. Let it be so. Let it be so. Let it be so. Thank you, God, for walking into our doubts. Thank you, God, for walking into our pains. Thank you, God, for dispelling them all like you did for the disciples. Thank you, God, for strengthening us to be immovable, unshakable, and giving us a resolve to be always abounding in the work of the Lord. Bless your people today. Strengthen your work. Build your church that the gates of hell will not prevail against it. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Know that we are praying for you. Know that we love you. Natalie sends her greetings. The staff send their love. We pray for you. There are some that we have not been able to reach. Forgive us. Please call us. Please let us know that you're well. If we haven't been in touch or connected with you, email us or call the main line. Leave us your number. We'd love to hear from you. If there's any prayer needs or any other physical needs, how we as the body of Christ can still reach out to you and minister to you. That is why we exist as the church. That is why we are here, to serve God and serve you, our fellow believers. We love you. And we pray this thing will end soon, that we can come together again and embrace one another. I so understand now what the scripture says, greet one another with a holy kiss. We long for the day of being reconciled and restored to fellowship in all ways. But until then, let's keep believing God. Let's keep connecting. Let's be the body, and let's be true brothers and sisters, and stay well together in Jesus' name. Have a wonderful day. Do join us tonight on our Zoom times, and we'd love to hear what Brother Jeff has to share with us this evening. And we have Zoom from Tuesday to Friday and Wednesday night. I'm doing a prophecy series. You're welcome to join in as well. God bless you. Have a wonderful day. From all of us here at New City Church, we love you, and we're praying God's richest blessing and His face to shine upon you all. In Jesus' name.